antigen distribution. And this is the result. So we numerically work this out, we optimize it, and this is the optimal repertoire. And what you see is that the optimal repertoire is made out of this discrete receptors, that tile space. So it's very peaked, it's not everywhere, but you just put receptors at certain positions, and then you have cross-reactivity, which you can think as a little envelope, just cover everybody else, okay? If you have a receptor here, cross-reactivity means that everybody around you will be covered, and so on. And so the idea of the optimal repertoire is that you don't have a receptor everywhere, you have them in certain places, but together with cross-reactivity, you cover all of space. And if you then look at the coverage that you get for all antigens, you see that this peak repertoire gives you essentially nearly uniform coverage for all antigens. So, and the interesting thing is that you're, thanks to that, you're equally protected. So it kind of follows the antigen distribution, but not very closely. And you're equally protected against the rare antigens, so places where you have very little weight, as you are against the very likely ones. There's no big difference. Okay, so you get the same thing in two dimensions. That wasn't really that interesting for this. Okay, so you can ask, well, what do I care about this? What are the consequences of this very theoretical approach? And so if we ask now the question, if we consider two individuals like you and I in the same environment, this room, or generally Bordeaux, and we, you know, so these two individuals are generally exposed to the same set of antigens, right? But we sample them slightly differently. So, you know, you may sample a little bit different set than I am. So say you sample the yellow one and I sample the blue one. And the question is now is, should you and I have the same distribution, optimal distribution receptors, or a different one? And the answer is we'll have a different optimal distribution of receptors. So the optimal one you can think of as the best case scenario. So in fact, the overlap between our repertoires will very quickly go down as a function of how differently we see the environment. Although the antigen distributions we see are still fairly similar, and so sorry, still fairly similar, and they both of these very different repertoires give us essentially complete coverage in this case. So all this is saying is that there's very many different ways to solve the same problem. This is illustrated with this cartoon. So you see the receptors here. If you look from far away, it looks exactly the same. But I drew the grid lines to show you that they're placed at very different places, but they're still managing to cover space. Okay, so that's the general idea. So the point is that there's many different solutions to the same problem, and we shouldn't be surprised that our immune repertoires are very different. Okay, because first of all, this is even in phenotypic space, and when I showed you the analysis of overlap, so on one hand I showed you that we can predict the overlap, I forgot to sort of accentuate that the actual numbers of receptors we share, anybody, even twins, is very low. Okay? In a sampling of, say, 100,000 receptors, we're going to share around 500 receptors. So it's really very, very small fraction. So we shouldn't be surprised that we do find very different solutions to the same problem, especially in sequence space, if already in phenotypic space, in recognition space, the same problem has many different solutions. Okay, so, okay, and I just wanted to say, since a lot of people have been considering dynamics, lymphocyte dynamics, that these kinds of dynamics, these kinds of solutions of discrete receptors covering space are the steady state solution of typical competitive dynamics that are usually considered in these systems, where two receptors compete for an antigen. Okay, so now do I stop? What's my time?
You still have time.
I still have time. Okay.
Yeah.
So this is okay. So let's move on. So generally, I start going towards abundances. So initially I talked about unique receptors, but of course the receptors are not unique. Clones have different frequencies. So you can look at the frequency versus rank distribution of different receptors, whether in human T cells or zebrafish B cells, and you see these very long tails. So what you do here is you make a list of receptors, you rank them by how numerous, how abundant you are. So this is rank one goes to the most abundant one, rank two to the second one, most abundant one, and so on. And here you put the frequency. So basically you see this is a huge spread. There's some receptors that have very large clones, and there's a lot of receptors that have very small clones. It's the same for over species, over B and T cells. And you could think that generally what this is a solution to try and figure out the distributions of pathogens in the environment. So there's also pathogens, they come in different frequencies, we have different probabilities of encountering them, and you could try and say what our immune system is doing is trying to predict the frequency of pathogens in the environment. And predicting the frequency of pathogens in the environment is an old problem. It goes down to the Middle Ages, where kings were trying to predict how many deer they have in the forest. Okay, that's where sort of these frequency arguments go back to. But now we replace deer mostly by, say, microbiome or ponds, but we're still very interested in predicting frequencies. So I'm gonna describe a way of trying to predict frequencies, and I'm going to, on top of that, try and say, maybe this is what the adaptive immune system is trying to do. So we're back to this picture now, but we're gonna think about it in a slightly different way. We're gonna say, if you have an immune repertoire that works quite well in, say, last year, how should it evolve to still work well against the pathogens that you'll encounter next year, right? Pathogens evolve smoothly. They evolve by mutational dynamics, right, or recombination, but there's an evolutionary dynamics along which it evolves to. So can our immune system make use of that and try and predict to be in a good state for protection in the future? So because is the adaptive immune system a good predictor of future pathogens? Okay, so in order to predict, you have to remember. And so luckily, the immune system has the capacity to remember. It has a memory repertoire, right? So after an infection, some part of these cells are given a flag saying you've been to war, and they're put in the memory repertoire. So if you see the same thing, they're going to respond more quickly. But you can ask the question of first of all, you can ask, is memory useful, for example, for prediction? But second of all, you can say, if I have memory, what's the optimal way to update memory? Should I have a proportional memory update, meaning every time I see a new receptor, I always update by the same amount? Or should I have a modulated memory update? For example, that I've seen a receptor 3 weeks in a row, the pathogen 3 weeks in a row, I get the idea, I'm not gonna update by humongous amounts each time. I'm gonna update by less and less, or more and more. Okay. So this is the idea of how you estimate. So those are the questions, now let's get to the answer. So you have some pathogen frequencies that now evolve with time. And they evolve in time according to some stochastic dynamics. You can think Wright Fisher dynamics or whatever you want, right? Typical things for which we assume for, say, flu evolution or typical dynamics. Then we have a receptor distribution that is trying to keep track of this evolution. We're going to assume And we're going to say that it's trying to keep track in a way that it's trying to minimize, again, the expected cost of an infection, where is the cost I, given a fixed pathogen distribution and a fixed repertoire, it's the cost I defined previously, and then we minimize the cost. However, there's a problem. Okay, sorry, let me go. However, there's a problem. We actually don't know, or our immune system does not know what the pathogenic environment is. The only way it has access to it is it samples it from time to time, right? We get an infection from time to time. That's when we interact with it. That's when we see what it is. But in general, you don't know what the space of all possible pathogens is. So we're going to assume that the immune system has a belief about the pathogen distribution. It has some idea of what it is, that it evolves according to the same dynamics. We're going to assume that the immune system knows the type of dynamics by which pathogens evolve, because it's had evolutionary timescales to learn it, okay? So in absence of any interaction, we're going to say the immune system just evolves according to these dynamics, but then every once in a while, it actually encounters, so it verifies, it sees the pathogen, and then it updates its state to meet that of reality, right? So you're there, you have some idea of how things should be doing, you follow what you think should be going on, and then you get hit in the face and told, wait, you should be over there, so you do that. And when you do that, when you update, that's when you proliferate, that's when your immune system has to produce more of the receptors that are actually going to fit the real environment, and you see a proliferation event, and then some part of them are kept in memory, and that's evolved some more. So the basic idea is that the immune system tries to predict these pathogen frequencies thanks to some prior belief that it evolves and frequent encounters where it updates its belief. Okay, so this is like a forecast. If you want, the belief is like a forecast. Okay, the memory. Okay, so we can again work through the details of this. I'm not going to show you that. This is the result. So we can now consider, again, go back to our effective phenotypic space, our recognition space, and we can consider three types of environments, a very sparse one, an intermediately sparse one, and a not so sparse one. Right? By sparse, I just mean that there's something that very rarely do you see a pathogen in this space. Most of it is empty. So basically here, there's not a lot of pathogens to learn, and here there's loads of pathogens to learn. And what I'm plotting here is a decrease in the cost of infection from some baseline as a function of the sampling parameter. So of course, the more you sample, the more your cost is reduced, right? The less you suffer, because you're learning more. Like the more, basic idea, the more you sample, the more you learn. So all of these curves go down with the sampling parameter. But you see that these are, the blue line is the sparse environment, this is the non-sparse environment, the color-coded. And it's much easier to learn a sparse environment. It's much easier to learn when you don't have a lot of things to learn, and then your cost of infection goes down much quicker. But in all cases, you see that thanks to the fact that you can remember and learn, your cost of infections goes down. So memory is useful, and it's useful because you can detect pathogens quickly. But the other interesting thing is that if you then rescale all of these curves by the sparseness parameter, you can collapse all of them. So this is the same thing as here, but just rescaled by how sparse the environment is. And so what that shows you is that there's really only two things that matter in this problem. One is sampling, and the other one is sparseness. So this is related to ideas in neuroscience about learning and compressive sensing, which are very, very efficient algorithms for learning a random environment. So this seems to work in a very similar way. But at the end of the day, this is a sort of rationalization that memory is useful. Okay, so now how do we relate this to reality? Well, if we look at basically, if we now look in data, so this is a cartoon but made up based on data, we see that as with age, as we age, our pathogen susceptibility goes very quickly down in infanthood and childhood, and at the same time our memory T cells shoot up, and then they plateau, both of these plateau in adulthood. And we see the same thing is predicted by our theory, that our susceptibility to infections goes down very, very quickly and then plateaus, and the memory T cells go up and then plateau. And this is, in our terms of our theory, we can explain that what's going on here is we're basically learning the sparse features of the environment. We're learning the easy things, and once we've learned them, we're left to learn the hard things, so the payoff is much smaller. It's much harder to learn the fine details of something. So we're able to reproduce these trends seen in data, and we can also answer the question of how you should update your memory repertoire. So this is the relative update with each subsequent infection, and you see that with each subsequent infection you should produce less and less memory cells against the same pathogen. So subsequent observation count as less evidence, and this can be linked directly to vaccination. So this is flu vaccination, and this is the pre-vaccination titer, and this is the post-vaccination titer. And you can see that for, so the dots are as experimental data, the green line is a prediction. You can see that for titers for receptors that already had a high titer, you basically don't update it, you keep the same level. But for ones for which you had a low titer, you updated a lot, but to a constant level. And that's exactly what's predicted by a theory, which is not what would be predicted by a constant fold chain, so a proportional memory update, or if there was no update. So you do need this modulated response that is the result of our theory. And then we can try and ask questions about the environment. So a typical memory increase is about 100 to 1,000 fold. So if you look around here, that gives us an inverse sparseness parameter of about 10 in this range. So then if we take the square root of that, that's a sparseness parameter of 10 to the minus 6, 10 to the minus 4. So that's, that seems like a very sparse environment. So how do we compare that to? So if we take an effective pathogen space of say 10 to the 5, so let's say that in our life we encounter of the order of 10 to the 5 completely different pathogens. If we go back to this collapse plot of how the decrease in the cost of infection, if we multiply this by 10 to the 5, we're around, well, 1. So 1 is here, and that gives us around a 2-fold decrease in cost if we only see a pathogen once. So that tells us that in these sparse environments, so basically memory is in a way useful because our environments are sparse. If they weren't sparse, then it'd be very hard to make memory useful, but in this case we can already get a 2-fold cost decrease with such memory. Okay, and last thing I want to say is that, of course, if you're going to learn something, the environment also changes, then an inherent part of learning is forgetting. So the faster your environment changes, the faster you want to forget. And so forgetting is an important element of learning, and you can also predict how you should forget. Okay, so I'll stop here. I won't read it because I feel I am over time. And if you have questions.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Alexandra. We have around 10 to 15 minutes for questions.